Good morning. I very much look forward to our discussions this morning. We have some very fascinating papers on both micro and macro aspect of conflict in Africa, and some very insightful and stimulating findings. I have three questions as we go on to discuss this important topic. That is, first, what can we achieve through development activities, and how to go about it? How do we see the interplay between politics and development? How do we see development actions being able to contribute to successful conflict resolution? For example, what concrete actions can we come with, design for a country like Central African Republic? My second question would be, how can we, external partners, outsiders, facilitate, steer, or otherwise influence political processes which are inherently complex and personality-driven? I'll tell you a little story, my little story. War started in northern Uganda, and at that time, when everybody was talking about war breaking out, and I went to the president and I said, why don't we stop it before it starts? And his reaction was, this is just a small group, a group of bandits, we'll deal with them, we'll deal with them and end the war. Now, it took 23 years after that, and it took a toll on the population and, of course, the amount of destruction. So how can we, as outsiders, be able to intervene early enough and make sure that there's political will in the case of, as far as the leaders are concerned? Could we have done something to prevent what happened in Burundi? Could we have done something to prevent what happened in South Sudan? Because all these problems do not start overnight. They're always brewing. And it's not because we do not have information about them, it's just inaction, which is very costly. I was discussing Boko Haram in Nigeria, and talking to the people, they knew this was coming. But again, there was no political will. Again, in here, it's a small problem, we'll deal with it. And at the end of the day, the cost of inaction is extremely high, and it's often more difficult to reverse the situation. So with that, we have, unfortunately, one of the presenters is not able to come. We have two very eminent presenters this morning, and yes, I have Chris Blattman, Associate Professor of Political Science and International Affairs at Columbia University. He has a PhD in economics from here at the University of California at Berkeley. He has published extensively on interventions to alleviate poverty, especially in post-conflict settings. Chris. I'll come back. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks to Ted and Mokhtar and everyone else for organizing this conference, for having me. I look up here and I hear California has a water problem. I even, you know, I feel this, it's especially worse because I actually brought my water from New York. I didn't want to impinge on the crisis, but. So this is a joint paper with a behavioral economist, Julian Jameson, and a cognitive psychologist, Margaret Sheridan. All right. It really starts with, you know, a simple question, which has, in some sense, consumed a lot of my research over the last 5 or 10 years, which is what to do with the highest risk man. This is a question at the forefront of a president's mind, of a World Bank country director's mind, of an NGO leader's mind, of an average, you know, citizen or community member. In Liberia, which is the setting I'm going to talk about today, these guys don't look like high-risk men. This profession, they're called wheelbarrow boys. They're not boys. Like virtually everyone else in the study that I'm going to talk about today, they're between about 18 and 30. But they rent these wheelbarrows by the day, and you come up with your car full of goods that you're wholesaling, and these guys run up, and you put your goods in their wheelbarrow, and they transport you to wherever you go. And this is probably how they fill 10 or 20 or 30 hours a week. But the other, when they're transporting this stuff, they're actually also notorious pickpockets. And the other 10 or 15 hours a week, they're engaged in other things. They might be doing a little armed robbery on the side. They might be engaged in con artistry. They might be engaged in drug selling. Many are drug users. The sample of men that we targeted, we tried to recruit 1,000 of the highest risk men in Monrovia. They'd committed or they self-reported about 1.25 crimes per week on average. So drug selling is also on the rise. So now a lot of this is marijuana, but more and more there are hard drugs, cocaine and opium and things, a spill-off, if you will, of the increasing drug trade that's going through West Africa en route to Europe. And this is a little, you'll see these little wicker shacks all over the city, especially in the slum and market areas. And these little wicker shacks are typically places where people are going to buy and sell and smoke and consume drugs. And so here's three guys, like the guys on the previous page, but one in three or two in three are generally ex-combatants. And about half of this sample, these 1,000 men we recruited, are daily drug users, typically marijuana, and one in five are actively selling. Now, high-risk men like this engaged in crime are a concern, not just because that crime has a social cost, but the UN peacekeeping force, the government, NGOs, civil society leaders are very concerned that these guys are going to be easily mobilized into violence. If you look at the equivalent population in Freetown, these guys are mobilized by political parties on both sides in neighboring Sierra Leone into political violence. So election thuggery is just one of the forms of violence that these guys are going to be more easily drawn into because they have both the time and perhaps the inclination, and they have a very low opportunity cost of time. A slightly more significant worry is something that Ted alluded to, which is, will they become mercenaries in outbreaks of war? This might be, God forbid, an outbreak of war in future in Liberia, but in late 2010, early 2011, there was some election violence that led to armed hostilities that for a short period of about a month or two became a civil war in Cote d'Ivoire between the opposition and the incumbent forces. And about 500 to 1,000 Liberian ex-combatants went as mercenaries for as little as $500 or $1,000. And when there was a coup in Guinea in 2008, there were rumors of recruitment, which fortunately never came to fruition, but this sort of pattern of mercenary recruitment in West Africa is a very common one. So this is one of my favorite pictures from Liberia. When I first arrived there in 2008, this is a perfect metaphor. It's justice under construction. This was the Ministry of Justice. The building is finished. The justice system has a little ways to go. So the usual response of a policymaker to these high-risk men really boils down to policing or jobs. And what these interventions have in common is they take the man as given. They essentially assume that they're fully formed, they can't themselves be changed, and we merely have to change their incentives or impose constraints. And there's a different approach, which is often referred to as rehabilitation, which says, what if men can change? What if people can change? And then, of course, because we're talking about crime and violence, we're talking overwhelmingly about young men. And rehabilitation programs are essentially adolescent or adult investment in certain skills, or I'm going to argue, image and identity. And this isn't something I believed. It's something I was very skeptical about, and in some level it didn't even occur to me. We're accustomed to seeing this in the world of economics and psychology when people talk about early childhood behavior, early childhood investments, and preschools. In fact, one of the main motivations for preschools is people are investing in skills and identities for very, very young people because there's an expectation that these early stage life investments have a really, really high return economically and in terms of reducing crime. There's a lot of evidence for this. Okay, but we're very skeptical that adults, someone who's 18 or 25, can change. So what are the returns to these adult investments? And I began asking this question because we stumbled into a program in Monrovia run by a group of ex-combatants and former criminals who had in some sense rehabilitated themselves and had spent the past decade building and fine-tuning and experimenting with a program that was designed to actually create that same change in high-risk young men like their former selves. And they were targeting former combatants, and they were targeting to street youth, and they were targeting to street criminals. And they called it the STYLE program, for Sustainable Transformation of Youth in Liberia. And STYLE was an 8-week program that I'll tell you in a bit more detail. Here's a picture of them. You can, all of the, this is a very poor picture, which is how you can tell it's mine. And this is this, I'll explain exactly what it is, but it's basically a group therapy for 8 weeks with two major aims. The first aim is to actually impart to these young men skills of self-control. So these are going to be skills of impulse control, of emotional regulation, of planfulness. And it's also going to try to get persuade them to try out a new self-image, a new identity as a normal member of society. The technique it uses is something called cognitive behavior therapy. This is one of the most common, well-evidenced techniques in developed countries for certain psychological disorders, be that depression, be that traumatic stress, be that anger management, be that addiction. And it's being applied to these different forms of behavior change, right? It's a method that's applied to different contents, different behaviors, different problematic ways of thinking. All right, and they're applying these techniques essentially by accident. They cobbled together all of these curricula and trainings and things from, and experimented with them over years and over a decade, evolved into this thing that surprisingly looked like American therapies for these types of disorders. It's 3 or 4 hours a day, 3 times a week, in these groups of 20. And they only get a meal in compensation for staying, mostly because they wouldn't have made any money that morning by coming with us. On the alternate days when they're not in the session, so the other 3 days a week, they're getting individual counseling. So the counselors, the two facilitators who run each session, are going and visiting them at home or meeting up with them where they work. And all of these counselors are actually ex-combatants and ex-street youth. Here's three of them, who made this transformation themselves in some previous iteration of the STYLE program. Okay, and the core element, what makes cognitive behavior therapy is two things. You can think of it as like a two-way street. What cognitive behavior therapy does is first it tries to make you aware of your problematic thinking and behaviors. So you explicitly lay out on the table what the problems are. You explicitly try to discuss either one-on-one or through group discussions and through various other means, what are the problems, what are the causes, what are the consequences, why are these harmful? And in a way that seems like any normal kind of talk therapy, right? And you bring it to the table, you bring it to the fore. And the idea is that partly just by talking and making these more explicit, you can hopefully affect people's behavior. But the core principle of CBT is that that's not enough. You actually have to change your thinking by changing your behaviors. And you start off with very small and easy tasks, And you get those positively enforced, and you try them out. And if you fail, you process those setbacks, and you try again, and harder and harder and harder. And it's by practicing these gradually harder and harder, more and more difficult, and more real situations, first through role-playing, then through practicing tasks, then through exposure to new situations, by processing your successes and failures with your counselor or as a group, that you eventually entrench these changes in your life. And in the context of our two changes, one of these is this fostering skills of self-control. So what is it that they're practicing? What are they learning? Well, one big thing they're learning, or just sort of think of it as sort of long-term planfulness, how to set appropriate goals, how to break those goals into concrete steps, and examples of that would be feed your family for the next week, or set a personal goal, like I actually want a garden in the plot, or I want to have a stable home to live in. Many of them do not. I want to give up drugs. I want to start a business. And then you work through these plans and you learn how to implement them. The other thing is much more of a more immediate kind of self-control, which we think of as impulse control or various forms of automatic behaviors, including a very special focus on anger. So for example, they will practice in role-playing and then eventually in real life non-aggressive responses to angry provocations. And they'll learn techniques for calming themselves and distracting themselves, counting to 10, certain breathing techniques. And they will practice them in class. And again, they'll do it through skits and role-playing and then practice it at home and then process failures and really try to build these into their life over the 8 weeks. And then the more unusual one, if you will, at least from an economist's perspective, is changing self-image and values. And right now, the way I've come to think of these men is they're men who think of themselves as outcasts, right? They know that stealing is wrong in society. They know that drug selling is wrong in society. They know that these angry fights and all these things that they're doing are wrong in society, but those values don't apply to them. I don't have to internalize those values. I don't have to psychically penalize myself for certain bad behaviors because that doesn't apply to me because I'm not a member of a normal society. And the purpose of style is to say, actually, why don't you try being a member of society? Why don't you see how it feels? Why don't you see if you can make that transition? Why don't you see if you can get this respect and self-actualization, all the things that you actually crave in life, just by trying to pretend you're normal and then gradually becoming normal. And so they'll start by just dressing differently. Here's a picture of where they get their haircuts. So in the second week, they come in and men are offered a haircut. And you know, two or three of the guys have already shown up by the second week having gotten their haircut. And they're starting without being prompted. Instead of wearing a ratty t-shirt, they've put on a t-shirt with a collar. They've gone in and bought one. Instead of wearing shorts, they're starting to wear pants. Instead of wearing sandals, they're wearing shoes. And they might come in with their hair cut. And they take off their dreads and they take off their facial hair, all the things that signal outwardly that they're kind of a troublesome youth, that they're a bad guy, that they're a tough guy. And they look clean cut like a normal guy. And two or three guys in the group will sit back and I'm not getting rid of my dreads, right? I'm not going to do this. And they sit back and they wait a few weeks. And one of two things happens. Some of those guys drift out of the program. Most people stay in. Once they start, they typically finish. But some of them drift away. But within two or three weeks, they see the guys coming back saying, you have no idea. My community's teaching me completely different, treating me completely differently. And they say, I want that for myself. And they go through that change. You change your home environment. You start cleaning up after yourself. And the counselors come and they follow up on that. So it's a mixture of self-control and this identity change. They have to practice going to a bank. They have to practice going to a shop. They have to practice going to a supermarket. And they often fail. They say the wrong thing or they behave the wrong way and someone kicks them out and they process that and they try again. Okay, so the setbacks are processed and they try again and the trying again is reinforced, and when they succeed, that's positively reinforced. So we evaluate two interventions. One is we evaluate experimentally with this group of 1,000 men that we recruit this cognitive behavior therapy, all right? But we overlay that following the cognitive behavior therapy, so we hold a lottery and half of the men are offered this therapy. But we do it. We also offer a cash grant a week or two after the therapy, a $200 cash grant, which is roughly what we calculated it would take to start a very small petty enterprise, usually in petty trading, plus have extra money for savings and the kinds of daily consumption that people need, like having a roof over your head or having more than one change of clothes. And so by these two sequential lotteries, we essentially end up with a quarter of the men receiving therapy, a quarter receiving just the grant, and a quarter receiving both, and a quarter receiving none. And the grant has two purposes. The grant is partly just a measurement device to say, if you're more planful, if you've changed your self-image, how do you spend money differently? Does this show up as a behavioral measure in your economic behavior? And then it's also an intervention, because we think that one of the main things holding back these young men from high return opportunities and alternatives to crime is capital, an absence of capital, a lack of credit, and they could make their way in petty business if they had this capital. And what we're going to do is we follow these men. First, we do this with a group of 100 because we think maybe the CBT is just nutty, and maybe the best use of $200 in this group is drug overdoses or buying a handgun. That could be your highest return capital investment. And our 100-person pilot assured us that actually these risks were not apparent at all. If anything, we had one death in the initial pilot, and this was among one of the control group members several months after treatment. A lot of the things we saw led us to realize that a lot of the two interventions are actually drastically reducing the risks these men were taking. So very briefly, one of the surprising things is that most of them, virtually all of the men, regardless of which treatment group they're in, spent the money in a very forward-looking way. The impulse control and the absence of planfulness, which we observed in them, seemed largely confined to a social domain. When given a large sum of money, they basically invested virtually all of it. Some of it was spent on consumption, but when it was consumed, it was spent on like housing and clothes and very normal, sensible things in which themselves are, in some sense, investments in a changed life. We do a short-term study survey 3 and 6 weeks after the intervention, and a long-term study 11 and 13 months after the interventions. And we are, because we have sort of a constrained sample, we're averaging our impacts over the short term and the long term. And this is a one way to sort of get highly volatile, potentially low powered outcomes, get more statistical power, get more exactitude. So we can look at the effects of on consumption or on weekly earnings. If you look to the weekly earnings, they're earning about, in the control group, which is the first bar, they're earning in the short term about $14 a week. That goes up marginally, not that significantly with any therapy. With cash only and with therapy plus cash, it's going up more significantly. So you're seeing like a 20, 30, 40% increase in their earnings per week because they're investing this in petty enterprises. So their earnings are going up a substantial amount by investing in these petty enterprises. Their consumption is also going up. But in the long run, these effects have dissipated. And the reason they've dissipated are several, but one of them, it turned out, and this was a surprise to us, is just how insecure their property rights were. Regardless of whether you received cash or not, or therapy or not, you were typically robbed 8 times a year. Someone, this might just be someone pickpocketing from you, it might be someone invading your home or whatever you call a home and taking everything, it might be someone stealing something from your business. And whatever capital you had was depleted. And you weren't more likely to be robbed if you received the cash, but you had more to lose. And so this is essentially what sets men back, so that a year later, they're really no better off than the control group. But what's interesting is in the short run, within a month, we see really dramatic reductions in self-reported crime and self-reported aggression and violence. I'm going to talk about why we should believe these are real. So we see, for example, that men are committing 1.25 crimes per week in the control group. And if you receive therapy only or therapy plus cash, this is going down by 30, 40, 50%. This could be any number of kinds of thefts or robberies. This could be whether or not you sold drugs in the past 2 weeks. All right, and this is sustained in the long term, but what's interesting is we only see these large 30, 40, 50% reductions in crime and violence in among the group who received both cash and therapy. Right, so the effects of therapy alone seem to be fleeting. They perhaps dissipate within a year. Even though we see some indication of some decrease, it's not very robust, but it seems to be large and robust among those who received both therapies and cash. Now I'll talk about why we think that is in a moment, but first let me tell you why we think we should believe some of this crime and violence data. So there are no administrative records. I don't actually believe arrest record data when these types of arrest record data are used in the United States. I'm actually not even sure what arrests are a proxy for, especially in the United States, perhaps also especially in Liberia. It's useful, but it's not, you know, it's also not a very good proxy for actual crimes. But these things are inherently unobservable. We're worried about two things. One, we're just worried that these are sensitive behaviors that people underreport in general, all right, which is going to essentially attenuate any treatment effects we find. But we're especially worried that if we put you in a room and lecture you on good behavior for 8 weeks, that you're more likely to tell us what we want to hear. Okay, this is obvious. At the same time, you could imagine it going the other way. You could imagine that if I give these guys a cash grant in therapy and you're in the control group, maybe you tell me what you think I want to hear, which is you're a good guy because you want to receive this program in future, right? And it could go either way. If it's the treatment group underreporting, then we've completely overreported the treatment effects. And if it's the control group underreporting, then we've actually underestimated the treatment effects. And what we did is we randomly selected about 1 in 12 surveys that we ran. We ran 4,000 inline surveys, 4 per person, over the year. And we selected 1 in 12 of those, and we basically had these ridiculously talented Liberian qualitative researchers who would go and hang out with you for 4 days. And their job after 4 days of trust building, of talking with you, of getting to know, and these guys are living full time in these neighborhoods for like a year because they're just constantly hanging out for 4 days with one of our survey respondents. Their job is you tell me 6 things about this guy. You tell me whether or not he steals, you tell me whether or not he uses drugs, you tell me whether or not he gambles, you tell me whether or not he's homeless, and you tell me whether or not he does these 2 types of non-sensitive things over the same time frame, like attending video clubs or paying money to charge his phone. And we're gonna look at the whether or not they're reporting sensitive and non-sensitive behaviors differently as a result of treatment. Right? We're not getting at the exact truth, but we're getting much better, we think, than a survey answer. And what's amazing is these guys come back to us And we can compare the survey to the qualitative data, and we actually see very little underreporting. These guys in general, there's no penalty to telling us they steal. They seem to be very forthcoming about this. There is a little bit of underreporting, and the underreporting is mainly in the control group. The control group, to some small extent, maybe 5 or 10%, are telling us what we want to hear. And this suggests that these 50% reductions in crime that we're observing, if we extrapolate from this qualitative exercise and if we believe it, if we extrapolate that to our broader treatment effects, we might even be underestimating the reductions in crime and violence by 5 or 10%. Let's get back to this question about what is it about therapy and cash together that seems to lead to sustained impacts, at least over a year. We have no idea right now what happens over beyond a year. So one is this idea that cash made you a better business person, gave you an income, and thus pulls you away through economic incentives from crime. And this, actually, we see some evidence that this is what happened in the short run in the first month, but that's clearly not what was going on in the long run after a year, because these guys don't have any economic gains. They've been set back. And so this can't be what's driving that result. We thought, well, maybe some of these crime is linked to addiction and drug needs, and if this therapy led to them to reduce their addiction, then they could actually then that might have actually reduced some of the incentives for crime. And this is true, but on a very small scale. We actually only see about 2 or 3% reductions in drug abuse. There's slightly larger, questionably significant reductions in the frequency of use, but in general, this wasn't an intervention designed to target addiction and drug use. CBT doesn't necessarily have a huge effectiveness on drug use in the large number of trials we have. So this doesn't seem to be explained either. Where we see big sustained changes of roughly the same magnitude are along these sort of theoretical mechanisms that were articulated by the guys who designed this program. And one is that they improve their self-control skills, a whole list of about 20 or 30 things that are all self-reported, standard psychological skills, and a whole set of anti-criminal values. And we see, as we see from here, we actually see these are standardized scales. My arrows kind of didn't make the transition from PC to Mac. And what we see actually is about a point to, among those who receive both therapy and cash, we see a 0.2 standard deviation increase in these self-reported self-control skills and these self-reported values. So whether or not they, and a lot of those changes in self-control skills are concentrated not in the long-term planfulness, but in emotional regulation and immediate impulse control. So what is it about? What is it that this program did, and why cash plus therapy? Well, our sense, both from the theory behind CBT and also from some extensive formal qualitative interviews that we did, so we followed these guys longitudinally, qualitatively over a year, often 4 or 5 times they were interviewed. Therapy starts you down the righteous path, and cash essentially buys you an extra 10 or 12 weeks of reinforcement, of an opportunity not to be pulled off the track of righteousness to into crime, to meet your immediate needs. It allows you instead to practice your skills of self-control by starting this business, practice being a respectable member of your community, change your own perception of yourself as well as other people's perceptions of yourself, at least until it's all stolen away from you. Okay, and there's parallels to this in sort of the U.S. CBT randomized trial literature on essentially booster sessions and how these seem to be very effective at making CBT changes, which is a very short program. Remember, we're talking about 8 weeks, 3 hours a day, 3 times a week. This is not long. All right, and so this is essentially a form of extension and reinforcement and practice of therapy's lessons. Again, this essential element of CBT, which is practice. What's striking, you look at our group, here's a group in Chicago, Becoming a Man program. There have been 3 randomized controlled trials. This just came out for the first time last week. 2 of the Becoming a Man program in various high schools with at-risk, not high-risk youth, but youth who are not necessarily actively involved in crime, but are at risk of participating in crime in inner-city high schools, and 1 in a juvenile detention facility with actual high-risk youth. And they see almost the same effects. They are just trials of therapy versus no therapy. And what they see are huge reductions in criminal behavior, although they persist only a year. Within a year, those changes in antisocial behavior have disappeared. All right. There wasn't necessarily an economic component to help sustain this change, which might have made a difference. We don't really know. That's speculative, but that's kind of what we see in Liberia. And so what this is suggesting is essentially character and self-image and self-control skills associated with especially emotional regulation. This Becoming a Man program is focused on all of very similar set of changes as in the STYLE program. But where the authors see the most change is, again, on emotional regulation and these automatic impulse responses, right, and people learning to control these, and these being linked to violence and crime, which, as it happens, are the skills that criminologists and sociologists often associate with the highest risk of crime. All right, so these characteristics are malleable, and they're malleable in adults, and they're also malleable in adolescents, not just things that are malleable in childhood. Okay, so what does this mean? What does this mean next? Also known as my slide for Betty and Mokhtar, because I'm going to come and ask you for money. So one, I think it's important to follow up these populations long term, including this Liberia population. I don't actually want to, because whatever gray hair I have is essentially due to these guys and trying to find them. They're so hard to find. It took us five person days to find each person each time. And we had to do this 4,000 times. So I like to say it's the hardest thing I ever did. Technically, it's the hardest thing I ever paid other people to do. I think we need to test alternate therapeutic approaches. So 4 weeks, 8 weeks, 12 weeks, 16 weeks. Also, what components are included. We deliberately took out one of Stiles' normal core components, which is trauma counseling. But there's reason to think that this is very complementary, especially in these violence-affected populations. Booster sessions, right? This was 8 weeks, then over. And we see these sustained changes. So what if we had booster sessions? Would that make therapy? And how do these compare cost-effectively to just handing out cash? And then when it comes to an economic intervention, we went for the very simple cash transfer because it was cheap. The whole program, getting both components, cost $500 a person, including all the administrative costs. So each component, cash was about $200 plus change to distribute, and the therapy, 8 weeks of therapy, cost $200. It's not a coincidence. We wanted to make them comparable in cost. But how do we protect property rights? What other interventions might lead these cash gains to be sustained? What other components other than just cash? Is it skills training? Is it something else? That will actually affect. We didn't frame this cash at all. We didn't say, here's your business startup grant. We said, here are 10 Andrew Jacksons in the palm of your hand. But what if these were framed differently? What if there were some conditionality or some supervision? Would that pay off? So we don't know, and I think this is a really problem. I mean, 50% sustained reductions, at least in a small population. The thing is, in most cities, these are small populations. There are 10,000 guys like this in Monrovia. There are 10,000 guys in Freetown. There's maybe 20,000 in Nairobi. There's maybe 30 or 40,000 in Joburg or other larger cities. But there's not a lot of them. So these are scalable also in the sense that, remember, we're creating our own facilitators. Right? This is if there are levels of human capital and organization in Liberia to make this happen, there are levels of human capital organization in every country on the planet. So I will just leave you with that. Thank you very much. Okay, I'm told we'll take two questions now and more questions with James at the end.
Yeah, two questions.
No, thank you, Chris. I'm waiting for the bill. Just on your policy implication, you say protecting property right and cash plus. Is there some indigeneity on protecting property right? Because they are the same people who are committing crime. Mm-hmm. So how would we distinguish the effect of having a policy on reducing property right?
Well, you'll notice I have a question mark. I probably could have put question marks after the sub-bullet points. I don't know. Now, how would I help these guys protect their property rights? Maybe they need the Liberian version of moving to opportunity, some voucher to help them move neighborhoods. I don't think that's the solution. We could get into a long discussion. We won't. Maybe it's home security, like simple things like just having a safe or having a more secure place to keep your things. I think there are things they could do. At the same time, half the time these guys were stolen from, it was by the police. The police were confiscating their goods. Technically, what they were doing is illegal. Right? They're buying these shoes and selling them. All right, and the police would confiscate them, not because they're worried about enforcing the law, although it might be an element of it, but because then they get to keep the confiscated goods. So helping these guys get licenses and protecting them against these kinds of seizures. So I don't know. I think it needs work. But it's not something we thought about. It kind of blindsided us. And this is, we like conflict scholars like to, economists who study conflict like to point out to the rest of economics that they take property rights for granted and they take security for granted, and yet we make the same mistake ourselves.
The slide follow-up,
on this. Was there something with your data that you could turn it more into an exploratory exercise to see what types of boys were more at risk and hence maybe had a different experience throughout the program as well as a different pattern after the program was over? There must be certain boys. Could we identify those, right? We mm-hmm. know from other work that the conflict exposure itself may have different effects on how people view life later on. You yourself right. have contributed to this. Could you learn more from the heterogeneity in your sample, basically, to paint part of this agenda?
Mm-hmm. So we did this a little bit, and we could do it more. We pre-specified sort of three kinds of heterogeneity analysis that we would do, so we wouldn't data mine, and we just look at those three. And one of them is whether or not you have impulse control problems in a time preference sense. So we play lots of experimental games with you to get your time preferences. We look at certain psychological problems associated with distress, and then we also look at your previous baseline antisocial behavior. So how antisocial are you? And the thing that comes out from this is overwhelmingly, the more antisocial men, meaning the men who are more engaged in crime, more engaged in violence and aggression, are not only more likely to stick with the program, but they are, almost all of the treatment effects are concentrated in the high antisocial group. So if we were to sort of look at a distribution of change, in some sense, oversimplistically, what this program is doing is it's taking people from the top of the distribution and putting them basically at the medium, right? Which is not necessarily how we think of changes. It's taking people with these things that are almost like disorders and helping them really reform themselves. And that's, I think that's really important. That makes it into the 50 or 60 minute version of the talk, maybe not the 20 minute.
We have time for one more question.
Yes, thank you very much. That was a very interesting presentation, and I like the mix of methods too, and I really like the subject matter. My name is Kathy Bain. I work at the World Bank, and I cover Nigeria from the governance program. But before I came to the bank, I spent a long time living and working with gangs on streets. And it strikes me that a lot of what you're saying here was very evidenced by the work I did, but also by the kind of evidence that somebody working on social work, which is what I was before I went back to grad school, had built a lot of. This was the kind of thing that we did with street kids on the street in Mexico City in the 80s, and there was evidence to prove what you're saying back then. So I guess my question is this really an area where this interdisciplinary approach that Magda was talking about at the beginning could go a bit further? Because I feel like a lot of this ground has had a lot written in other disciplines, including what I read in the 80s, at the risk of aging myself in social work. And then my second question would be that based on that experience and that evidence from other disciplines, I think under the sustainability issue, it's really important to keep looking at the therapy thing. This is not something that goes on for a year. This is something that goes on for a lifetime. And I think looking at how the therapy issue evolves and the way that people continue to receive, but also to give back into that therapy community is something that economists really should keep an eye on.
That's a great question. So in the US, there's a fair amount of evidence on these kinds of approaches with youth in correctional institutions and youth at risk of criminal activities, including gang membership associated with criminal activities. And this actually seems to be best practice in the United States, proven through a number of relatively small and not always powered randomized controlled trials, but you know, after 40 of them, it starts to point in the same direction. So we feel confident about that for that reason. There was just a Campbell systematic review, actually it's still underway, which was looking at all of the summation of anti-gang participation prevention evidence that passes some minimal threshold of quality of evidence in all developing countries. And they came up with zero studies. They couldn't find a single one. This one and a few others actually don't count because we didn't mention the word gang. But nonetheless, it's not like, so there's this, what's striking is there's so little evidence, at least in developing countries. And that evidence is important, not just because it's a different context, but because, you know, we weren't competing with a gang here. We were competing with a lot of economic opportunities and structures I think might eventually become gangs, but are not presently. Like many aspects of society, government, civil society, et cetera, the gangs and criminals are also relatively disorganized in Liberia. But in an extreme sense, I wouldn't think this would work in Guatemala City, because if you try to exit the gang in Guatemala City, they will shoot you. All right, and that's in some sense the strongest gang culture probably you can find in any hemisphere. But in that's not actually true in most gangs, or so I understand from people who study these things in developing or developed countries. And so we might expect though this to work with some struggle in the context of gangs, because there's going to be a this is an institution or set of organizations that's competing with us for their identity and is actively trying to do, like, if you, the style program is essentially what armed groups, militaries, and gangs do in reverse, right? It's trying to give them, we're trying to give them a competing identity, and these gangs would fight back. So it's actually hard to know how this would work in those situations. So this is going to be a really important area for study, especially in Latin America. Okay.